When we talked about index structures and also join implementations, we have already seen the use of hashing for such purposes. We will now revisit static hashing schemes and then investigate two popular dynamic hashing approaches. In general, the idea of hashing is the following. We want to partition the space into so-called buckets. And we do this by the use of a hash function. We call it usually h. And h maps the space of data, for instance, keys like integer keys, to n buckets. The idea here is that the number of buckets n is much smaller than the space of possible keys that are used as the input to the hash function. We have already seen, as I mentioned, applications of hashing, for instance, searching for join partners in the hash join and also for indexing data using hash-based indices. In the ideal case, H is injective. That means there are no collisions. So we have our space of, let's say, integers of a certain column, matriculation number, and then we come up with a hash function that maps these matriculation numbers, so these keys given in the database table, collision-free to hash buckets. In this case, every data record can be found according to the key with only one page access. Unfortunately, this can only be realized if the keys or the set of keys is dense. Otherwise, you cannot derive such a hash function which is perfect. Or it doesn't make sense, let's say, to do that. Let's have a look at an example. So we have here a page that stores different numbers. The capacity of this page is 4. And we see here that we have already 3 entries inside the page. The keys inside are 15, 50, and 20. And if you now insert an additional item, then this page is full. And now what happens if there's another data record that needs to be inserted? Well, certainly it does not fit into the page, so you have to deal with it. One way to deal with it is to create another page. We call this an overflow page, where we store this record that did not fit anymore into the original page. Here you see an illustration of such an overflow handling using separate overflowing pages. When you're visiting this bucket, according to your hash function, you will find a pointer that is pointing to the secondary page. And if you're searching for a certain object with a key, then you not only have to visit this one, but obviously also the other page. Unfortunately, this can go on. If you have many more collisions, in the end, you're losing this desired property of having a constant lookup cost, ideally over one access only. Or two. If this goes on, and then I mentioned this already earlier, then the performance of hash-based indexing or hash buckets can degenerate and tending towards a linear cost, which is of course not what you want. Before we talk about individual approaches, let's have a look at two ways to classify approaches. First, into the class of approaches that have no directory. So you have the data space here on the left-hand side. And examples we have seen previously where you're applying, let's say, some modulo hashing, and this gives you the position in a primary file where the page is located. So you have the object here, you apply hash function, and the hash function will point to a position inside a file on disk. Overflow pages are stored in another file. We call this the secondary file. The alternative to this is to use a separate directory. So the data space is here again on the left side. The hash function is pointing to a certain position inside the directory, for instance here. And the directory is doing the mapping to the actual location inside the file. The directory also, of course, grows or has to be adapted to the number of records. And we assume that also later on, when we talk about approaches with directory, that this directory does not fit in main memory itself. Let's have a look at some simple ways to organize hash tables in a static case. That means they are not growing in number. So we have a certain number of pages. We can have overflow pages, but we will not change the number of primary pages. These are the pages which are in the primary file. A little bit of notation. So we have n records. We have np pages and ns secondary pages, which are the overflow pages in the previous example. We can distinguish between the capacity of primary pages and the capacity of secondary pages, but usually we do not do that. And then if we have this information, we can compute so-called storage space utilization, which is simply the number of records divided by the potential space which is available in these pages. Let's have a look at some simple overflow page-based hashing scheme. So we see here we have five buckets and a sequence of integers we want to index. We have already indexed or inserted these numbers here up to 50. And you see here, for instance, there's like only one space left and so on. Now let's continue inserting more values, for instance, 88. You see that this is falling here. It's still no problem. It's all fine. We still have enough space left. So we go on in inserting 73. Still no problem. And now we see that we have a problem because 33 does not fit anymore in bucket with ID 3. So we have to create an overflow bucket, and which is then referenced from the initial bucket. So we go on, inserting 92, no problem. Inserting 19 causes a problem because the bucket here was already full. And then we see that we have to create another overflow bucket. This is very simple. I mean, there's not anything hidden there. It's really as simple as it looks. So we continue inserting. And in the end, we see again, we have some overflow. But this is fine because anyway, we have already an overflow bucket created. And we are done. So what we have seen in the previous example was the method that is doing overflow handling by creating additional buckets, so-called overflow buckets. An alternative is to use some probing mechanism that will try or is trying to find a place in a bucket which is still free. So how this works here in this case, we look at linear probing. So assume we have the hash function h, we can apply on the key h of k, and this is full. And then we look at a sequence of buckets, which we look at next. And if one of these, the first one that is free, we will insert the page into. So we apply the hash function on our key as usual. And then we add, this should be an I obviously. So we apply, we're adding one value ranging from zero. This is like, of course, the initial hash function. And then we add one or two and so on, modulo the number of pages. And this is giving us basically an alternate way to hash, pointing to a sequence of buckets. And we take the first in this order, which is free, and we insert our value or our data record into. Let's have a look how this works. So we again have our sequence inserted and we start. Now the next one will be 88. You see there's no problem. There's still enough space left. Then we're creating, we're adding 73, it's also no problem. You have space left. And now the 33 caused problems because the bucket where it should go into is full already. And then we look at the bucket 3, which was the initial hash value, plus 1, modulo 5, which is 4. And this is also full, so we cannot insert it here. You see why linear probing has the name. We go in a linear way through that hash table and checking the buckets in a linear fashion. And due to the modulo for the next try is 3 plus 2 modulo 5, which is ID 0. So basically, we start here in the beginning and we look at this bucket 0 and we see there is space, so we can insert it there. Of course, you see this is eliminating the need of overflow buckets, but still, you have to pay additional costs because you have to look also when you're searching for the possible bucket that this item that you're searching for is inserted. And for inserting, there's also additional cost, of course. This continues and, we see again there's a problem inserting 19, and then again we have to probe multiple times in a linear way in order to find the new location of 19, and so on. Also not super complicated. The important thing, the trick here, is that we're adding like 0, 1, 2, 3, and so on to the initial hash function. And this is our new hash function, basically, that we're probing, to be used to probe these individual places in our hash table. Okay, then next one is we can also use randomized probing. Linear probing was clear, right? So we go in a linear way through that. And now here in linear, in randomized probing, we create a random sequence, a random number sequence based on the key. And important, of course, is that this is deterministic, because for when we're querying this key K to find the data record associated with it, we have to also find it, right? We cannot just have random numbers by arbitrarily placing this record into the hash table. We have to do it in a deterministic fashion. So the random number generator is basically seeded with a key K, if you want to think about this like that. A better way to get rid of these overflow buckets, or get rid of like an immense number of overflow buckets, because a few overflow buckets are also not really the problem, just if there are too many. So a way to get rid of this is forgetting about these static schemes entirely and come up with a solution that we call dynamic hashing techniques. Here we are able to adjust the number of primary pages, so the buckets in our hash table, to the data that is coming into our system and makes our data set growing. Why is this not trivial? Well, it's not trivial because if you have a hash function, for instance, something like this, k modulo 5, that was used so far in the examples, and now we say, well, 5 is not enough, we need more buckets. So then we say, let's use the hash function k modulo 6. Well, what this causes is that you have to shift around a lot of data, and you have to reorganize basically your index so far. So here on the left side, you see the primary file and the secondary file for the modulo 5 hashing. And on the right side, you see what's happening if we change the hash function to modulo 6. And if you're looking closely here, what's happening is that you have to, for instance, have the item with 15, ID 15, you have to move it to the bucket 3 from bucket 0. So you have to do a lot of reshuffling. And that's, of course, costly. So whenever you think you want to create, like you need more space, and you're creating this, you're increasing this parameter here from 5 to 6, and then the system will be busy for a while and cannot answer queries because you have to reorganize the entire index, your hash table. But that's certainly not what you want to do. And we will see in the following two very smart and very elegant ways in order to come up with a hashing function which can dynamically adapt to the increasing data volumes.